العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد. Today inshallah we are meant to talk about الإمام الشافعي and الإمام أحمد رحمهما الله تعالى. So we spoke last time about Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Malik رحمهما الله. May Allah have mercy upon them both. And we briefly explained a little bit of the history behind Imam Abu Hanifa and his madhab. We talked about some of the main principles in his madhab. We did the same as well with Imam Malik, generally speaking. So we got a glimpse into each of the these two madhabs. Now it's time to deal with, just to have a glimpse into madhab al-Imam al-Shafi'i and then madhab al-Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal. Imam al-Shafi'i being born the year 150 after Hijrah gave him an advantage. So he was born the year 150 and he lived 54 years. So he died relatively young. Relatively young. So he died at the age of 54. So he died 2 or 4 after Hijrah. Imam al-Shafi'i, in his time, al-Khilaf al-Abbasiyya, the Abbasi Caliphate, was established. Was in its peak, actually. That's the peak of the Abbasi, al-Khilaf al-Abbasiyya, the Abbaside Caliphate. And that meant there was a lot of stability. There was a lot of knowledge as well, so people were free to travel. There was less turmoil. Revolutions, almost completely subdued. And that, as I said, gave a lot of tranquility in the society, the general society. This also contributed to the intellectual, scientific movement. So the scholars were, people were feeling safe, everything was available, there was a state of affluence, generally speaking. There was a state of affluence. People were able, scholars, as we said, were able to travel safely and meet different scholars and learn from them, and so on and so forth. And that had an impact. So Imam Shafi'i, actually, it was obviously tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he was born, or he lived in a time where everything seems to conspire to make him an imam. An imam. So when he was born, he showed signs of intelligence and he was exceptional compared to his peers and his friends. So he memorized the Quran from a young age. Between 6 and 7, he completed the memorization of the Quran. At age seven, he completed the memorization of the Quran. And also from a young age, he lived most of his time with Banu Hudayl. Banu Hudayl. This is one of the Arab tribes that maintained their Bedouin nomad tradition. Specifically the language, the purity of the Arabic language. So Imam Shafi'i learned their language and learned their Bedouin nature as well. And we said, you know, generally speaking, the Bedouins, specifically at that time, there was a lot of manliness in their approach to life. So this is why even, you remember from the life of the Prophet ﷺ, that the kids in Mecca used to be sent to the Bedouins outside of Mecca, outside the cities. Why? Because of the fresh air, the good quality of food, and the noble like character that generally the Bedouins were known for, the language, the nobility and the I would say eliteness of the language, and also because of their lifestyle, there was a lot of manliness, there was a lot of responsibility from a young age. So this would contribute to the growth of the young man specifically. That would contribute a great deal of traits, personal traits that are desired. So Imam Shafi'i spent on and off with Banu Hudayl around 10 years. So he learned a lot from them. Even the Imams of Al-Lugha, the Imams of the Arabic language, like even the Imams of, or the I would say the Imams of Al-Shi'r, of Arabic poetry, like Al-Asma'i. Imam Al-Asma'i was a scholar of Hadith, but he was not like one of the main famous ones. He was also an Imam of Al-Lugha, Imam in the Arabic language, and specifically in poetry. So he says, صححت أشعار اللغة على فتى من قريش يقال له محمد بن إدريس. He said, I checked the poems of the Arabs, that's pre-Islam and during Islam. So he says, I checked them for authenticity. So I checked what I had with the authority. And that's a young man from Quraysh named Muhammad ibn Idris. And that's a Shafi'i. Muhammad ibn Idris Shafi'i. So an imam in the poetry, he goes and checks and verifies his own collection of Arabic poetry with Muhammad ibn Idris Shafi'i, shows that, you know, how profound and well-established he is in the Arabic language. So from a young age, as we said, he excelled. And he traveled to meet Imam Malik when he was around 10, 11 years old. Prior to that, he had memorized Al-Muwatta. He had memorized Al-Muwatta of Imam Malik. He memorized it completely. And when he went to meet Imam Malik, Imam Malik, when he saw him, he said, Ya Muhammad, اتق الله ولا تعصه فإن لك شأنا. He said to him, fear Allah and do not commit sins, do not transgress against the limits of Allah, because I can see you will have a future. You have a promising future. That's Imam Malik. So Imam Shafi'i became a student with Imam Malik. He stayed with him around 10 years or a bit more. He studied with him and he learned from him. And he was considered to be one of the main students of Imam Malik. And that in his early stage, he was a follower of the madhab of Imam Malik. But madhab in that time was not very well established as we know it now. Okay, so it was basically a teacher's style. So he was a follower and he was a defender of Imam Malik for the early stage of his life, Imam Shafi'i. Some of the stories mention that when he, the first time he travels to Medina to learn from its scholars, he was 9 years old. His father passed away when he was still young, but his mother raised him. So she sent him to Medina to learn. So he met with, when he was to set out from Mecca, he needed to join a caravan. So he found one of the caravans, and the caravans were like moving, traveling daily. It was like a train station. So every couple of hours there would be a caravan setting out to northward to Medina from Mecca. So he found a caravan and he asked if he could join them. They said, absolutely, you can join us. And he was, obviously, it was strange. Someone about 9 years old traveling by himself. So they admired that about him. They invited him. They were having some food, so they invited him over. He joined them. One of the old men in the caravan, he was a man of wisdom, obviously, so he noticed that this was no normal young man. He was so special. So he approaches him, he says, you are from Quraysh. He said, yes. He says, you are from the most noble among Quraysh. He said, how did you know? He said, because we invited you to food and you agreed. وَالَّذِي يَقْبَلُ كَرَمَ النَّاسِ كَرِيمٌ. He said, we invite you to eat with us. And usually the people who respond to invitations with respect, they themselves are generous. So I noticed that in you. Second of all, I noticed that you are silent most of the time and you're a deep thinker. And that's not very common. Anyway, so the journey would take around, if they like moved quickly, it would take around 3-4 days to reach Medina. 3-4 days to reach Medina. Imam Shafi'i kept to himself. And the people in the caravan used to argue over petty things. Like, you ate more bread than I did, or you were like probably marching a little bit faster than us, that caused us to be tired, etc. and so on. And so on. So people were arguing. You know, people sometimes, you know, their arguments erupt over small things, insignificant things. It happens. Imam Shafi'i kept to himself. When they reached Medina, like some people said, oh no, you didn't engage in any of our like socialization. He turned to them and he said, to that guy, he said, I mean, it's fine for your socialization, but on the way, I've revised the Quran more than 9 times on the way. So I was revising the Quran as he was on his probably camel or horse, and three times every day, he revised the whole Quran from his memory. So that shows from a young age, he was so focused, he knew what he wanted. Anyway, so Imam Shafi'i grew up, and as I said, he learned a lot from Imam Malik, and he was one of his main students. Then he returned to Mecca from Medina. He learned again with the Imams in Mecca, who obviously, and in Mecca was the knowledge mainly of Ibn Abbas specifically. The knowledge of Ibn Abbas, so the students and students of the students of Ibn Abbas and Abdullah ibn Umar as well. So he learned, studied with them. And when he was in his early 30s, the governor of Yemen visited Mecca and he was introduced to Imam Shafi'i. He liked him and he said, why don't you come and join me and become one of, I would basically put you in charge in one of the areas under my governance. So he made him the Wali of Najran, or the Al-Amil ala Najran, basically the person who watches over Najran. Najran is to the south of Saudi Arabia, on the borders with Yemen now. So you watch over that area. So you're more of a governor, okay? More of a governor. So Imam Shafi'i actually took that position. It's a position, government position. And at the time he was in his early 30s, 31 probably. But Imam Shafi'i was very strict, people would play games, people would bribe, etc. He would not accept that, he would not take that. This created him a lot of enemies, so they managed actually to create problems and spread rumors about him that he was from the Shia, that he was Shia, that he actually believed that Khilafah of Abu Bakr, Khilafah of Umar al-Khattab, Khilafah of Uthman were invalid, and so on and so forth. But obviously he was not, but this was a lie. So he was taken as captive, he was arrested by the police with some of his friends. All of them were killed except for Imam Shafi'i. Because Imam Shafi'i had very strong, he was very articulate, so he could defend himself. In Arabic we say كَانَ قَوِيَّ الْحُجَّةِ. He was very persuasive. So the governor himself, he could not even find a way or a loophole to accuse him or find anything against him. And what happened at that time, Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani, whom Shafi'i had met before. Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani is the student of Abu Hanifa, one of the main students of Abu Hanifa. He had met Imam al-Shafi'i once previously. So when he heard about this, he interfered with al-Mansur, the Khalifa in Baghdad. And he praised Imam al-Shafi'i and he put a word for him. So that helped, get Imam al-Shafi'i, acquit him of any kind of, absolve him of any kind of accusation against him. So he went free. He decided to leave the government positions and to focus on knowledge. That time he was 34 years old. Still young, 34 years old. So he decides to go to Iraq, study with Imam Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani. And he studied with Imam Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani. Imam Shafi'i said that I learned from him, and when I left Iraq, I had the knowledge that I learned from Muhammad bin al-Hasan al-Shaybani written in books that was a full load of a camel. It's huge. And he says, all of it's still in my head. So he learned a lot from Imam Muhammad bin Hassan al-Shaybani. So that's the advantage that Imam al-Shafi'i got. Look at, for example, the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa did not put principles for his madhab, but it's his students that started distilling the principles. They started to see the patterns of the fiqh of Imam Abu Hanifa and make it as principles. The same with Imam Malik. Imam Malik did not say, okay, these are the principles or the dynamics in the background of my madhab. He didn't say this. But his students later on developed that and they wrote down their fatawa and they documented that. But Imam Abu Hanifa and Malik, they did not themselves worry so much about this. So these details were taken care of by their students. So Imam Shafi'i benefited from all of this documentation. It was all available to him. So he was able to take from all of this. So he benefited from that. So when he left Iraq, he came back to Mecca. Now he started teaching. By the way, Imam Shafi'i started teaching. There are two different views. He started teaching when he was 15. The other view, he started teaching when he was 18. started teaching in the Haram, in Mecca. So from a young age, he excelled and he was recognized as an authority. So when he came back from Iraq, notice, we remember what we said about Madrasat al-Hadith in Medina and Hijaz in Mecca as well, but mainly in Medina. And Madrasat Ahl al-Ra'i, the people of opinion and intellect and analogy, which was in Iraq. Imam al-Shafi'i, these two schools of thought were in a state of conflict. So the ones in Iraq were criticizing the people in Medina and Mecca and Hijaz, and vice versa. So it was a state of conflict. Imam al-Shafi'i had the advantage of studying with both schools. So he had access to both schools. And he did not go against them. He combined them. So that was the advantage of Imam al-Shafi'i. By virtue of him coming later than Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Malik, he got the advantage to see what the points of contention were, what the differences were. And obviously, at his time as well, the hadith was more documented than at their times. So he got more advantage, more exposure. So his point was to resolve that kind of contention or disagreement between Ahl al-Hijaz and Ahl al-Iraq, which is the people of al-Hadith and the people of al-Ra'i. And this is when Imam al-Shafi'i actually wrote his book, Al-Risala. It was Abdul Rahman bin Mahdi who asked him, he said, write a book that describes the principles of your approach, of your madhab. So now Imam al-Shafi'i started to move away from madhab Malik. He started to develop his own school of thought. He started now to develop his own school of thought. So the early features of his madhab started to become clear. So he wrote Al-Risala. Abdul Rahman bin Mahdi says, every time, he says, I read this book countless times. He says, every time I read it, I learn something new. And he says, I make dua for Imam al-Shafi'i all the time. All the time. There's a statement that's sometimes attributed to Imam Ahmad, but it's been questioned. Imam Ahmad is one of the students of Imam al-Shafi'i, but he said, basically, it's not emphatically attributed to Imam Ahmad, but it was said by someone, most likely, probably Imam Ahmad. It says, كَانَ أَهْلُ الرَّأْيِ يَلْعَنُونَنَا وَنَلْعَنُهُمْ. Imam Ahmad is so much focused on hadith. So he says, the people of al-Ra'i, of intellect and analogy, they used to curse us and we curse them. Basically, like we used to disagree with them, they disagree with us, we criticize them, they criticize. There were some kind of intellectual battle between us. إِلَىٰ أَنْ جَاءَ الشَّافِعِي فَوَفَّقَ بَيْنَنَا. Until Shafi'i came and he created a reconciliation, a harmony between both. So that was a great contribution over Imam Shafi'i, and this is what his madhab is actually based upon. And it's not something that bringing two things together just like that. No, you need, there's a work of integration. It has to be authentic. It's not just bringing two entities and like putting them together. It doesn't work. But it was a work, intelligent work of integration of the principles of them. So Imam Shafi'i started something very unique. He documented the principles of his own school of thought. And that's unique. So you don't find this, for example, as we said, from Imam Abu Hanifa or Imam Malik, because they were basically, it's their students who took their madhahab and they then classified them, organized them, deduced the principles and so on and so forth. Imam Shafi'i himself was aware of the principles, he created them, he put them together, he designed them nicely, and this is how he built his fiqh. And you referred to this last week, right? About inductive and deductive approach. So that was Imam Shafi'i's approach. So he developed greatly. He became an imam from that time. From that time, he was in his late 30s when he became a well-recognized imam, to the extent that people would come from all parts of the Muslim world to study with an Imam Shafi'i. I want to share with you some statements of praise about Imam Shafi'i. This is the book of Al-Risala. Book of Al-Risala by Imam Shafi'i. This is the first book written on usul al-fiqh. The first book written on usul al-fiqh. This copy that's still available there, it was, mashallah, verified and brought out by Ahmed Shakir, the well-known scholar of hadith, Ahmed Shakir, from Egypt, who passed away probably 50, 60 years ago. Rahimahullah. He was probably the main authority of hadith at his time. So he says, لو جاز, this is the introduction he wrote for the Risala. He said, لو جاز لعالم أن يقلد عالما لكان أولى الناس عندي أن يقلد الشافعي. He said, if it were permissible for a scholar to make taqleed of another scholar, in my opinion, it would be a Shafi'i to make taqleed of. That's his personal opinion. Another statement of praise is basically, Ahmed ibn Hanbal came from Iraq to visit Imam al-Shafi'i and learn from him. So one of his friends, one of the friends of Imam al-Shafi'i, Imam Ahmed, blamed him. And he said, you leave the class or the halaqa of Sufyan ibn Uyayna, the great scholar, who is also the Shaykh of al-Shafi'i. Sufyan ibn Uyayna was also the Shaykh of al-Shafi'i, the teacher of al-Shafi'i. He says, you leave the halaqa of Ibn Uyayna and you sit with this Bedouin talking about al-Shafi'i. So Imam Ahmed says to him, uskut, you know, stay quiet. إِنَّكَ إِنْ فَاتَكَ حَدِيثٌ بِعُلُوْ وَجَدْتَهُ بِنُزُولٍ. If there is a hadith that came to you through a long chain of narration, or that you missed through a very short chain of narration, you will still find it with Imam al-Shafi'i from another way. وَإِنْ فَاتَكَ عَقْلُ هَذَا. Oh, he says basically, if I miss a hadith through a short chain of narration, through Sufyan ibn Uyayna, okay, I will still find it through someone else. It might be a longer chain of narration, yes. But وَإِنَّكَ إِنْ فَاتَكَ عَقْلُ هَذَا أَخَافُ أَنْ لَا تَجِدَهُ. But if you miss the intellect and the understanding of this man, he's talking about Shafi'i, I'm afraid you won't find it elsewhere. So he's saying basically, I might miss a hadith from Ibn Uyayna, but I will find it somewhere else. But if I miss the intellect and the understanding of this man, I'm afraid I won't find it anywhere else. So this is indispensable. So it's a matter of choice. مَا رَأَيْتُ أَحَدًا أَفْقَهَ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ مِنْ هَذَا الْفَتَىٰ. I have not seen a man who has an understanding of the Book of Allah like this young man. Although Imam Ahmad was younger than him. Dawood bin Ali al-Zahiri, who started as a Shafi'i but later on changed. He's the Imam, or the one who established al-Zahiriyya, the literalist, extreme literalists. He says about al-Shafi'i, he says, قَالَ لِي إِسْحَاقْ إِبْنُ رَاهَوَيْهِ. One of the great scholars, إِسْحَاقْ إِبْنُ رَاهَوَيْهِ, said, ذَهَبْتُ أَنَا وَأَحْمَدُ. He was a friend, close friend of Imam Ahmad. He says, when I went with Imam Ahmad to al-Shafi'i in Mecca and I asked him about certain things. So I found him very eloquent in his language and very beautiful in character. فَوَجَدْتُهُ فَصِيحًا حَسَنَ الْأَدَبِ فَلَمَّا فَارَقْنَاهُ. So when we, you know, we're done with questions and we left, أَعْلَمَنِي جَمَاعَةٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْفَهْمِ بِالْقُرْآنِ. Some people of knowledge of the Qur'an, they told me, أَنَّهُ كَانَ أَعْلَمَ النَّاسِ فِي زَمَانِهِ بِمَعَانِ الْقُرْآنِ. So the people who understand the Qur'an, they told me that this man, al-Shafi'i, was the most knowledgeable of the meanings of the Qur'an of our times. وَأَنَّهُ قَدْ أُوْتِيَ فِيهِ فَهْمًا. He's been granted by Allah a deep understanding of it. فَلَوْ كُنْتُ عَرَفْتُهُ لَلَزِمْتُهُ. Had I really known this, I would have stayed with him. I would have kept close company of him. Imam Ahmed says, لَوْلَ الشَّافِعِي مَا عَرَفْنَا فِقْهَ الْحَدِيثِ. He said, had it not been for the Shafi'i, we would not have received the understanding of the hadith. And that's by virtue of Imam Shafi'i combining Madrasat al-Hadith with Madrasat al-Ra'i. Yes, the fiqh of Imam Malik and the people of Hijaz with the fiqh of Imam Abu Hanifa and the people of Iraq. Imam Ahmed bin Hanbal, his son Abdullah, who was one of his main students, he says to him, like, إِنِّي أَرَاكَ تُكْثِرُ الدُّعَاءَ لِلشَّافِعِي. I see that, I notice that you also make dua for Shafi'i all the time. He says, yes, I always say, اللهم اغفر لي ولوالدي وللشافعي. He says, I always say, oh Allah, forgive me my sins, forgive my parents their sins, and forgive Imam Shafi'i's sins all the time. So he said, Ya Bunay, كان الشافعي, that's after the death of الشافعي, كان الشافعي كالشمس للدنيا والعافية للناس فهل عن مثل هذا من عوض. He says, oh my son, Imam Shafi'i was like the sun for the earth, and he was like health for the bodies of people. And he says, is there any replacement for a man whose description is like this? So you can see how Imam Shafi'i was, he had a profound impact. A lot of his students and other scholars, they said, had it not been for the Shafi'i, we would not be able to have any, we would not be able to have any proof about fiqh or anything. We would not be able to use proofs properly. It was all for Imam Shafi'i. So Imam Shafi'i, although he lived a short life, still he had a very powerful and big impact on the development of fiqh, on the development of fiqh. Now Imam Shafi'i, after staying in Mecca for a while, obviously he came back from Iraq, stayed in Mecca for a while, became very well known Imam, he decided to go again to Iraq. So he went to Iraq again. Obviously the first time he missed Abu Yusuf al-Qadi, the first student of Imam Abu Hanifa. He missed him because Imam Abu Yusuf al-Qadi had already passed away when Imam al-Shafi'i arrived the first time. Okay, now the second visit of Imam al-Shafi'i to Iraq, he went there again to learn from its scholars and discuss with them and have some kind of exchange of ideas. And he became an Imam there as well. He became recognized, people came to learn from him. Then he came back to Mecca. Some of his students say he went back a third time to Iraq, but like staying in Iraq was not easy for him because now the time when the Khilaf al-Abbasiyya or the Abbaside Caliphate started to get more people to help them out. The closest people to them, they were mainly Persian. Some of them were even, their Islam was doubted sometimes. So that caused some kind of trouble within the caliphate itself. Within the caliphate itself. So Imam Shafi'i decided, because he was invited by the governor of Egypt. The governor of Egypt at the time was a descendant of Abdullah bin Abbas, his grandson. So he invited Imam Shafi'i to come to Egypt and he said, we will take care of you here. You're like, you can have a good place to stay within us. So Imam Shafi'i decided to move to Egypt. So he went to Egypt and he learned from its scholars, specifically the students of Al-Layth ibn Sa'd. Al-Layth ibn Sa'd. And that's where Imam Shafi'i said his famous statement when he said, Al-Layth afqahu min Malik, ولكن تلاميذه لم يقوموا بمذهبه كتلاميذ الإمام مالك. He said, Al-Layth ibn Sa'd has more understanding, a probably better quality understanding than Imam Malik. But his students did not carry his madhab like the students of Imam Malik. So Imam Shafi'i in Egypt, having all this experience, he reached a level of maturity. In Iraq, he wrote a book that's called Al-Hujjah. Al-Hujjah, that contains his fiqh. This contains his fiqh. But when he came to Egypt and settled there for a while, it seems Egypt as well was flourishing at the time. So there was a lot to learn. So he learned and he matured personally and in terms of knowledge and studying. So what happened? Imam Shafi'i now changed some of his opinions, changed some of his fiqh. So he wrote a new version of a risala. He wrote a new version of a risala, and this is the one that we have. That's the second version. Most likely the first version was lost, the one that he wrote in Iraq. So that was the final risala that he wrote. And then he wrote his own madhab. Like, it's not his students. He wrote his own fiqh in a book. That's the famous book of Imam al-Shafi'i. That's called Al-Umm. Kitab al-Umm. That contains the fiqh of Imam al-Shafi'i. So this is why Imam al-Shafi'i, usually when you look into the madhab of al-Shafi'i, when they mention the statements of Imam al-Shafi'i, they say fil qadim wal jadid. Al qadim was his old madhab, the first madhab, when he was mainly in Iraq and probably sometimes in Mecca. And his al jadid when he was in Egypt. That's the new, the most recent madhab opinion. So this is why usually you have two statements or two opinions from Imam al-Shafi'i. And he himself in his, sometimes in his book, he would document the difference of opinion that he had or the development of his own opinions. So Imam al-Shafi'i, as I said, he spent these last few years of his life in Egypt, and that's where he died. That's where he died. His madhab flourished and was mainly established in Egypt. Then it went to Sham. Some people took it in Sham in Iraq. Later on, it spread into more into certain parts of Asia Minor. So it went into what's known today as Afghanistan and Pakistan, a little bit of India, and then it traveled with some people into Malaysia, Indonesia. So now it's still like in Malaysia and Indonesia, their madhab is in madhab al-Shafi'i. They follow al-madhab al-Shafi'i. You'll have some pockets in Pakistan, India, somewhere in Turkey, there are Shafi'is. A little bit in Iraq as well, there are some pockets of Shafi'is. In Sham, there are Shafi'is. In later years or later centuries, Shafi'is madhab developed a little bit in Sham. So you will find some of the madhab or some of the followers of Imam Shafi'i in Sham. But mainly the fortress of madhab Imam Shafi'i was mainly in Egypt. And also in Hijaz, some of the people followed the madhab of Imam Shafi'i. So you will find them there as well. Yemen, at some stage was mainly Shafi'i. And I think until today as well, most of the Yemenis follow the madhab al-Shafi'i. The Sunnis in Yemen follow the madhab al-Shafi'i. Madhab al-Shafi'i spread. So in terms of spreading, the two like main madhabs was Imam Abu Hanifa's madhab, like we find today, and Imam al-Shafi'i's madhab. That's last three centuries. Their madhabs are probably competing in terms of popularity and numbers. So in terms of how widespread the madhab is, Imam Abu Hanifa's madhab and Imam al-Shafi'i, they are probably competing in terms of number. Okay, to a lesser extent, al-madhab al-Maliki, and to a lesser extent is al-madhab al-Hanbali. Let's see what else we can say about Imam al-Shafi'i. Okay, one of his students, Mohamed bin Abdul Hakam, one of his students in Egypt, he says, لولا الشافعي ما عرفت كيف أرد على أحد وبه عرفت ما عرفت وهو الذي علمني القياس رحمه الله فكان صاحب سنة وأثر وفضل وخير مع لسان فصيح بليغ وعقل صحيح رصين. He says, had it not been for the Shafi'i, I would not have developed the ability to, you know, like, have discussion and reply to people who disagree with me in terms of fiqh. And it's through Imam al-Shafi'i that I know what I know. He's the one who taught me analogy and qiyas. He was a man of sunnah, so he was a follower of the sunnah, and the athar that came, the narrations that came from the companions, وَفَضْلٍ وَخَيْرٍ. He's a man of virtue and goodness in himself. مَعَ لِسَانٍ فَصِيحٍ بَلِيغٍ. Very eloquent tongue. وَعَقْلٍ صَحِيحٍ رَصِينٍ. A very intelligent and right mind, sharp mind. So that's a description of Imam al-Shafi'i by one of his students. Al-Rabi', one of the famous students of Imam al-Shafi'i, he says, كان الشافعي رحمه الله يجلس في حلقته إذا صلى الصبح فيجيئه أهل القرآن. He says, Imam al-Shafi'i, when he prayed Fajr, then he would sit for his halaqah. The people who study the Qur'an and sciences of the Qur'an, they would come to learn from him. فإذا طلعت الشمس قاموا. Once after sunrise, they would leave. Imam al-Shafi'i would stay. Then the students of hadith would come and learn from him. جاء أهل الحديث فيسألونه تفسيره ومعانيه. The students of hadith would come to him and ask him for the meanings and the tafsir of the hadith. Then he says, when afterwards, after a while, فإذا ارتفعت الشمس قاموا فاستوت الحلقة للمذاكرة والنظر. So he says, when afterwards, then it was time for discussions, and for reviewing what has been memorized. So Imam Shafi'i would review what he memorized or what students memorized. He would do that with some of his students. والنظر, النظر is discussion. النظر here is discussion. So they would discuss issues of fiqh. So it was more of an intellectual approach. فإذا ارتفع الضحى, so after الضحى, which is close to ظهر time, let's say around 11 these days, تفرقوا, then everyone would go back home or go to their own business. These are the students. Imam Shafi'i would stay. وجاء أهل العربية والعروض والنحو والشعر. Then the students of language would come. Those who study language, those who study poetry and the rhymes, and those who study grammar and morphology. They would come and they would sit with Imam Shafi'i to learn from him until midday. So you can see in every science he was a teacher and an authority. Okay, Imam Shafi'i, generally speaking, as we said, he was mainly a student for Imam Malik. He also took the fiqh of Al-Awza'i through the student of Al-Awza'i, which is Umar ibn Abi Salama. And he also took the, as we said in Egypt, the fiqh or the madhab of Al-Layth ibn Sa'd from his students, mainly Yahya ibn Hassan. And he also took the fiqh of Abu Hanifa from Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. So he had quite good exposure to the different madhahab that were available in his time. Imam al-Shafi'i, generally speaking, was a person of, he would hold on to the text. He would hold on to the text. So he was, and this is why he has a musnad. Imam al-Shafi'i has a musnad, a book of hadith, a book of hadith, a musnad. That's, as we said, classified based on the names of the narrating companions, the companions who narrated the hadith. Imam Shafi'i at his time, the Mu'tazila opinions started to appear and he was completely against them. He was completely against them. The fiqh of Imam Shafi'i, basically, for him, the main source of Sharia is Al-Kitab wa Sunnah, the Qur'an and the Sunnah. These are the main source. And for him, the Qur'an has authority over everything. But he says when it comes to taking rulings, the Qur'an and the Sunnah, you know, act together. So he says for him, like, and that's according to most of his students, that a Sunnah that could... As-Sunnah tukhassisu al-Qur'an. So there could be a general statement in the Qur'an. We have a hadith. The hadith could actually put a context for this verse. Put a context, a limiting context for this verse. It's possible. That's his fiqh. So for him, in terms of legislative authority, the Qur'an and the Sunnah were pretty much at the same level, because both of them are revelation. And then he says, for him, we don't find from the Qur'an, the Qur'an, the Sunnah, add to this, so the sources of Tashri'ah, Qur'an, Sunnah, and Al-Ijma'ah. Al-Ijma'ah, which is the consensus. And Imam Shafi'i was very careful to claim what was consensus. So not anything, because for him, you needed to have a proper consensus, and that wasn't easy. So Imam Shafi'i was very careful. And this is where Imam Ahmad also learned this specific point from Imam Shafi'i. So Imam Shafi'i was very careful as to where to claim ijma'. So he says ijma' is something that is known usually among the companions, the main things about Islam. But when it was a marginal issue and someone says there's ijma', for Imam Shafi'i he would question this, because you would need to investigate. Really, is there anyone who disagrees with this? Probably there is someone. So Imam Shafi'i was very careful about this. The third, or what comes after this, so if there's an issue that we do not find something from the Qur'an or the Sunnah that addresses it directly, we don't find an ijma' consensus about it, Imam Shafi'i would resort third to the statements from the companions. And he would choose from among them, if the companions differed, he would choose the statement that in his understanding is closest to the Qur'an and the Sunnah. If he did not find anything about this, then he would resort to Al-Qiyas analogy. he would resort to al-qiyas, which is analogy. So Imam al-Shafi'i, comparing him to Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam al-Shafi'i made qiyas come a bit later. So qiyas or analogy plays a more important role in the madhab of Imam Abi Hanifa. Imam al-Shafi'i pushed it a little bit later. So he would put in front of it statements of the companions. He said, لا نخرج عن أقوال صحابة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He says, if we have a statement from the companions, even if they disagreed, we do not depart from their opinions. So we take one of them, but we do not come up with a new opinion. So we have to choose from the options that we have among the companions. Okay? In the Hanafi madhab, there is more space there. There is more use of analogy. And we saw how Imam Abu Hanifa, as we said, was very careful as well when to accept a hadith. So he was, like, his criteria was stringent with accepting hadith. Because as we said, that was justified because at his time there was a lot of lying against the Prophet, and there was a lot of fabricated hadith. So he would be very careful before he takes a hadith. He would verify it. If he could not verify it, he would not take it. And he would use here qiyas. He would use qiyas. So basically, Imam al-Shafi'i had a disagreement with point in the Hanafi madhab, which is al-istihsan. Remember al-istihsan? We said if there's an issue and there's no statement from the Quran or the Sunnah about it, there's no ijma'. So in the Hanafi madhab, okay, the taste, it's not like a random taste, it's the taste of a scholar, yeah, who's developed his understanding of the Quran and the Sunnah, and his taste of Sharia plays a role in, you know, coming up with a ruling over this thing. So his general judgment, the judgment, okay, that is developed with a proper taste from the scholar, that's istihsan. Imam al-Shafi'i is against this. Imam al-Shafi'i says, no, this has no place with the sources of Sharia. So this is why in his book, Al-Umm, Imam al-Shafi'i has a chapter called Ibtal al-Istihsan, the nullification of istihsan. He goes against it. He goes against it. But anyway, like the later scholars of, that's the point to put forth for the Hanafi scholars. The Hanafi scholars later on, they qualified istihsan and they said it's a form of qiyas. It's an informed form of qiyas. And this has strength. This opinion has strength. But anyway, there is a hazy area between both. So it's a matter of debate between scholars there. Okay? So the later scholars of the Hanafi madhab, they basically said istihsan is actually a form of qiyas. So the scholar would not deem this issue to be good or bad, his personal taste or judgment, except based on his knowledge of Sharia. So he would be using qiyas of what he knows in Sharia and compare it to what he has in hand. See the point? Okay. Okay, that's generally speaking about Imam al-Shafi'i and his madhab. Imam Shafi'i did not really spread in the North Africa, apart from Egypt mainly, in Algeria, Morocco, Mauritania, or Andalus. Imam Shafi'i's madhab did not really, you know, gain followers. It was mainly Maliki madhab there. Imam al-Shafi'i, he wrote the principles of his own madhab in his book al-Risala. He wrote his own madhab, Kitab al-Hujja in Iraq first, then Kitab al-Umm in Egypt later on. Then the students of Imam al-Shafi'i, they developed also his madhab. And as we said, when we say madhab, it's not one person. It's not one person. Yes, the Imam started the school of thought and the principles, but yet later on the scholars developed and improved the madhab. So you'll find this in the Hanafi madhab, the Maliki madhab, the Shafi'i madhab. This is why Shafi'iyya, for example, when they talk about issues, if they have a statement from Imam al-Shafi'i, they would say Nassal Shafi'iyyu. Shafi'i has spoke explicitly about this. So there's a terminology, specific terminology for the Shafi'i madhab. when they say وَالْرَاجِحُ كَذَا, or the most likely, they're usually comparing the two madhabs of Imam Shafi'i, the older one and the newer one. So they have certain statements. And then they would have statements for scholars who came later on. So the ones who study the madhab al-Shafi'i thoroughly, they can tell from the books of al-Shafi'i which are the opinions of Imam al-Shafi'i and which are the opinions of the later scholars of Imam of the madhab al-Shafi'i. Like Imam al-Muzani, one of the main students of Imam al-Shafi'i, he himself wrote his own fiqh, and it's one of the main like sources in the Hanafi, in the Shafi'i fiqh. Also, you have Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, later on came Shafi'i. So his books became an authority. Then Imam al-Ghazali, one of the main authorities in fiqh al-Shafi'i. Then mainly Imam al-Nawawi. Imam al-Nawawi, like he's, let's say, one of the later scholars of the, and the main pillars of al-Madhab al-Shafi'i. He himself has his own opinions. He has his own opinions. Still respected and even like looked up, like he's looked up to in al-Madhab al-Shafi'i. So when we say madhab, basically we're talking about the imam that established the madhab, the principles, and later on it developed by the students. So this is when we talk about madhab. So when someone says you're following this specific madhab, I'm specifically talking about scholars. I'm not talking about blind followings. I'm not talking about blind following that has as well this sense of what we say at-ta'assub. At-ta'assub is a sense of bigotry, a sense of cynicism against people who follow other madhab. We're not talking about this. We're talking about the scholars who follow a madhab and they understand the principles of the madhab and they understand the Quran and the Sunnah and they relate to that and they evaluate the opinions based on the contextual evidence or the textual evidence, which is the Quran and the Sunnah. You will find this in all the madhab. So when someone says, oh, these are just following a madhab or the opinion of one person, that's inaccurate. A madhab is the development of fiqh, school of thought. And it's not like a madhab, there's no Quran and Sunnah. No, the scholars of the madhab have always been going back to the Quran and the Sunnah, and sometimes they would even change. Like Abu Yusuf al-Qadi made a lot of fatawa in opposition, or not necessarily in opposition, but that are completely different from Abu Hanifa's fatawa. Was that lack of loyalty? No, on the contrary. He held on to the principles of Abu Hanifa. But by virtue of living further after Abu Hanifa, he came across many hadith that did not reach Iraq at the time of Abu Hanifa. So later on he came to learn about these hadith and he realized if Imam Abu Hanifa were alive at this time and he came across this authentic hadith, he would absolutely change his opinion. So that's how the scholars have always developed the madhab in that sense. Okay? So that's, and following the madhab in that sense is legitimate. And the scholars have always done this. So the imam usually grows within a madhab, and after he reaches a high level of ijtihad, slowly they start departing from al-madhab. But they're still called like so-and-so al-Shafi'i, so-and-so al-Hanbali, so-and-so al-Hanafi. Scholars have always been like this. So this kind of name or title at the end doesn't mean, oh, he's a blind follower. No, it means that's where he started, that's his foundations, his roots, that's his base of fiqh, and from there he flourished and developed. Okay? So we need to understand the heritage of our scholars properly without doing injustice to them. And as I said, we should not mix the proper following of the madhab, which is enlightened with the divine revelation. We should not mix this with ta'assub. Okay? We're not talking about ta'assub. Then it's time to talk about Imam Ahmad. Imam Ahmad was born the year 164 and died 241. So he lived around 77 years. Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah. He was born in Baghdad. And he comes from the tribe of Shayban. Al-Shaybani. And this tribe was based in south Iraq, around al-Basra. His father died when he was still a little child, so he was brought up by his mother. From a young age, Imam Ahmad showed signs of excellence and intelligence and righteousness. So from a young age, Imam Ahmad was very righteous, very straightforward, righteous person. First, he studied, surprisingly, one of his early teachers was Abu Yusuf al-Qadi, the student of Imam Abu Hanifa. So Imam Ahmad first started with Madrasat al-Ra'i, with the school of intellect, analogy, okay, and reason. That's where he started. Then he left this school and decided to lean more into the hadith later on. Okay, let's can take a minute, inshallah, just talking about him. So Imam Ahmad first learned in Iraq, then he moved to Asham, traveled to Asham, to Al-Hijaz, Mecca and Medina. He learned from the scholars there. And he also went to Yemen. He went to Yemen to study with Abdul Razzaq al-San'ani. You know, the one who wrote Musannaf, Abdul Razzaq, Imam Abdul Razzaq al-San'ani. Imam Ahmad met him in Mecca, and then he decided even to go to Yemen, to Sana'a, to study with him. So he studied with him. And obviously when he met Imam Shafi'i in Mecca, and then Imam Shafi'i, when he went to Iraq, Imam Ahmad learned from him so much, and he became one of his main students. So Imam Ahmad was one of the main students. He had a lot to do with Imam Shafi'i. So there was great friendship among them. They were very close to each other, Imam Shafi'i and Imam Ahmad. Imam Shafi'i, or Imam Ahmad, focused so much on hadith. He focused so much on hadith, to the extent that some of the scholars of his time, they said, ما رأيت أحفظ like Abu Zur'a al-Razi, one of the great scholars of hadith. He is the authority of the hadith of his time, and he saw most of the students and scholars of hadith. When he was asked who's the most knowledgeable of hadith, he said, I haven't seen like Imam Ahmad. لم أرى أحفظ من أحمد بن حنبل. I haven't seen anyone who has memorized and learned more than Imam Ahmad. It's said that Imam Ahmad knew by heart 200,000 hadith, authentic hadith, and 100,000 weak hadith. He knew them by heart. Still, Imam Ahmad would not teach from his memory, out of wara', he was so careful, so cautious, so he would only teach from his books, although he had them in his head. But he still teach from his books. So Imam Ahmad focused so much on hadith and decided to become a very strong muhaddith, but he had the virtue by studying with Muhammad bin Hassan, with Abu Yusuf al-Qadi, and being established in Madrasat al-Ra'i, and then studying with Imam al-Shafi'i, and studying with other scholars, obviously he gained a lot of this. A lot of understanding. So he was a muhaddith of top class muhaddith, and he was also a faqih, top class faqih. So that's the specialty of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, although he was learned from a very young age, he refused to teach from an early age. So he decided to teach only upon reaching the age 40. And he would not give fatwa until he reached the age 40. Imam Ahmad was known for what they call in Arabic as-sakina wal-waqar. Sakina wal-waqar. He had a sense of respect, humility. He had his own presence. He had a very strong presence that was calm, quiet. That's Imam Ahmad, generally speaking. A lot of his students, when they talk about him, they describe him in that sense. Imam Ahmad went through a trial. And that was basically in the Khilaf al-Abbasiyya, specifically with al-Ma'mun, Khalif al-Ma'mun. Someone of al-Mu'tazila really became close to him, specifically Ibn Abi Du'ad. And al-Mu'tazila, there's a philosophical background to their approach to Aqidah. And they were quite argumentative. They tried to use logic to explain Aqidah sometimes and argue with the people of the scripture and non-Muslims. And that led to issues and problems in their approach and in some of their beliefs. So they reached a conclusion based on their principles that basically the Quran is not the words of Allah, but it's basically something Allah created. So for them, the Quran was not the words of Allah in the sense that these are Allah's words. No, but they say Allah created these words, created them as a creation. Although this, like to the general Muslim, what's this argument? But for them, it was based on certain principles. And the scholars of Islam, they stood firm against this, that this wasn't the truth. But the issue in Al-Mu'tazila came close to Al-Ma'mun. They got to the point where Al-Ma'mun wanted everyone to embrace this statement. To embrace this statement. So he would bring the scholars into his presence and he would question them about this. So if they agreed, he would let them go. If they disagreed to his statement or to that statement, he would send them to prison and they would be lashed. They would go through torture and so on and so forth. They would be persecuted. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal was one of those. And he refused to say that statement. And some scholars really went through so much hardship to the point where they just said that to protect their own lives. They just said that statement to protect their own lives. But Imam Ahmad is very well known that he is the one who really stood firm in this fitna. He stood firm in this fitna. He did not respond to it. He refused to say this statement. And he also refused to rebel against the Khalifa. When some people approached him, they said, well, he's changing the religion because that statement is kufr. That statement in itself is kufr. So forcing it on people is a real issue. So for them, they wanted to rebel against the Khalifa. He said, no. He said, no. And Imam Ahmad, because of this, he was imprisoned. He was lashed. He went through so much hardship to the extent that he was about even to die. He was on the verge of dying because of the persecution. And subhanAllah, that gave him popularity and love among the people. And one of these stories actually, where he was overly persecuted and lashed, and some scholars said to him, some good scholars of Ahlul Sunnah said to him, you know, it's just a statement, say it to save your life. You're not, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنٌ بِالْإِيمَانِ. You know, if you say the statement of kufr, being forced into it, you're saying this just to save yourself, there's no harm on you. So with excessive advice, Imam Ahmad thought of this. So In that story, it says that the general masses of the Muslims were gathered by the Khalifa so that they would listen to Imam Ahmad because he gained so much popularity. So Imam Ahmad would confirm the statement that the Quran was a creation, one of the creations of Allah. When Imam Ahmad was brought and he saw the masses, he said, أَمُوتُ وَلَا أُضِلُّ هَؤُلَاءَ. He said, I'd rather die than send these people astray or say a misleading statement to them. No. And that actually made his trial even worse. But Imam Ahmad remained firm upon this. His skin obviously like came off because of the excessive like torture in the prison. And this was for such a long time. I think he was in the prison for 28 months. 28 months, that's 2 years, 4 months. He was in the prison in that torture. During the Khilafah of Al-Ma'mun, Al-Mu'tasim, and then Al-Wathiq. During the Khilafah of Al-Wathiq, Al-Wathiq let them go, but he basically said to Imam Ahmad, you are not allowed to teach, you're banned from teaching or public speech. You can't make any public statements, you can't teach, that's it, you stay at home. So there's a funny story of someone who traveled to come to see Imam Ahmad, and he wanted Imam Ahmad to teach him hadith. So he traveled from a long distance. He came to Imam Ahmad, to his house. Imam Ahmad told him, I can't teach you, I'm not supposed to teach, I'm not allowed to teach, I can't. Obviously, I won't jeopardize my life for that. So the man insisted and says, I said, I travel, I came to you. I think he came from Egypt to him. And he said, I came and to learn and all that stuff. I sold all my properties, all my belongings to be able to come here. And so Imam Ahmad said to him, listen, if you want, you can pretend. He gave him a trick. You can pretend to be someone who sells maybe bread. So you can go and to the baker, get bread. You come to me as if you are selling it to me. So you sit on the door waiting for me, and I'll be behind the door giving you the hadith, and then I will open the door and I will take the bread from you and I'll give you the money. So the man basically used to come to the door of Imam Ahmad every day just for this. And he learned from Imam Ahmad so many hadith. And then afterwards, when the ban was lifted from Imam Ahmad, and that the ban was more than five years. That person, I can't remember his name, subhanAllah. He became one of the closest students of Imam Ahmad. Now Imam Ahmad, after this, he gained so much popularity and love among the masses. So much popularity. And so you can see the patient character of Imam Ahmad, that despite what happened to him, he was calm, he was balanced, he did not go and rebel or create problems. So Imam Ahmad was, as I said, he focused so much on hadith that he became an authority on hadith. So he wrote his Musnad, and we said his Musnad has 28,000 unique hadiths, narrations, plus change. Imam Ahmad did not like writing down his fatawa or his thing. So one day his son asked him, he said, you don't like writing books, so why did you compile this Musnad? He said, I wanted this to be a reference so people who need to learn the hadith and check the hadith, they can always refer to it. They can come back to it. And actually, until today, Al-Musnad is one of the main references of hadith. So Imam Ahmad, basically the Musnad was scattered pages. When Imam Ahmad felt that he was close to his death, he requested his son Abdullah and some of his students to bring all of these pieces together and organize them so that his compilation is complete. So Imam Ahmad himself, he did not write down his own fiqh like Imam al-Shafi'i. He avoided this. He didn't want to do this. But who wrote his madhab? It was his students, including his son Abdullah. So you have Masail Imam Ahmad from his son Abdullah. You have also the Masail from his students, like Masail al-Khalal, Masail Imam Ahmad by al-Khalal, etc. and others. So it's his students that wrote their questions and his fatawa. So, but his madhab, his fatawa, his fiqh was documented by his students. Al-Musnad has mainly authentic hadiths and hasan hadiths and weak hadiths. There is some kind of discussion among the scholars. Does it have fabricated hadith and so on and so forth? But most likely, it doesn't have fabricated hadith. It might have some weak hadith, but there is a fiqh behind these weak hadith because they have a use still. Maybe not directly, as we said previously, not directly take a ruling from them, but they might have an indication in the chain of narration about certain narrators. There might be something there in them. Now let's come to the principles of Imam Ahmad's madhab. For him, it was the text had the ultimate authority, which is the Quran and the Sunnah. The Quran and the authentic hadith had ultimate authority in fiqh. So Imam Ahmad would stick to the text, Quran and Sunnah, and not depart from it. For him, he made this the basis of his madhab. Holding on to the apparent meaning, not the literal. We say the apparent meaning. Literal is more of an extreme kind of approach. The apparent meaning, the direct, obvious meaning of the text. He would hold on to this and he would build his madhab mainly on this. Second source for him was the fatawa of the companions. So for example, with taking the text, Imam Ahmad, when he dealt with the, remember the, if a woman was divorced 3 times by her husband, does she take a nafaqa? Does she take providence or some kind of money from him for her expenses? Remember that the Prophet Fatima bint Qais said yes, but Umar ibn al-Khattab refused to take her narration because he questioned it. So Imam Ahmad discarded Umar ibn al-Khattab's opinion and he took the hadith. He said, no, that's the text? No way. We don't take anything other than the text. And Imam Ahmad would not take even the opinion of a companion or a tabi'i if it contradicts or if it seems to be in contradiction with the Qur'an or Sunnah. Second source, we said the fatawa of the companions. The fatawa of the companions. And so Imam Ahmad would mainly take what the companions agreed upon or what opinions were known upon them without opposition. Like if there was an opinion among the companions that had no counter opinion, he would absolutely hold on to this. So he would hold on to these. If the companions differed, Imam Ahmad would choose from their opinions the ones that are closest to the text. The ones that are closest to the text. And he would not come up with a new opinion. And he would not take the opinion of someone else other than the companions. If there's a number of opinions by the companions, he would choose from among these opinions. And he would not seek anything else. Obviously, when there's no text. Imam Ahmad would consider, but this is a sensitive issue with Imam Ahmad. Okay, because Imam Ahmad used to call hadith al-sahih, which is authentic, clearly authentic, but there is al-hadith al-hasan, which has some weakness, but it's still sound. We call it sound hasan. Imam Ahmad, his classification, and that's the general classification, sahih, hasan, sound, and da'if, weak, okay, which is not strong enough to be taken, and fabricated. That's the general classification of the scholars. Imam Ahmad had a different classification. He had sahih and he had da'if. That's his classification. So sahih is authentic. Da'if for him is not one level. It has sub levels, sub categories. So among the da'if, for him, the highest level of da'if, which we call hasan, or generally the general scholars call it hasan. Call it hasan. And then there would be another level of da'if which is less, which we call da'if, which is not acceptable, generally speaking, especially in fiqh, not taken. So there are statements from Imam Ahmad that if he did not find from the Quran or the authentic Sunnah Sahih, and he did not find from the companions, he would take what he calls da'if, hadith al-da'if, but not all of it. He would take what we are calling hasan. He would take what we call hasan. So that's an issue with the terminology. But there is something, Imam Ahmad would take what we call al-mursal. Hadith al-mursal is basically what is narrated from one of the tabi'een, that one of the tabi'een says, the Prophet ﷺ said such and such. Okay, this man from a tabi'een did not meet the Prophet ﷺ. He's from a tabi'een. He's not a companion. So he did not meet the Prophet ﷺ. So he is saying, the Prophet ﷺ said such and such. This is considered to be hadith mursal. Mursal. It's one of the hadith that have gaps in the chain of narration. Most of the scholars consider these to be weak. They don't consider them. But Imam Ahmad says there are certain marasil, certain types of mursal like this, when it comes from certain tabi'een, that these tabi'een would not refer this hadith to the Prophet ﷺ unless they know that it's authentic. Like Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, Hassan al-Basri. Okay? So he would choose from these marasil what he deems to be authentic. So if he did not find in the Quran the authentic hadith, he did not find from the fatawa of the companions,
he would then resort not to qiyas like a Shafi'i, no, he would resort even to these marasil that tabi'een quote from the Prophet directly. But not all of them, as we said, the ones that he knows from certain tabi'een. Then Imam Ahmad, finally, he would resort to qiyas. He would resort to qiyas. He would resort to qiyas. And he has, in his fatawa, he has a lot of qiyas. The main students of Imam Ahmad and the ones who spread his madhab is his son, Abdullah, and he has another son called Salih as well. So imagine his own children are his own students as well. That's special. Abu Bakr ibn al-Athram, Abu Bakr Ahmad al-Athram, Abdul Malik ibn Mahran al-Maymuni, Abdul Malik ibn Mahran al-Maymuni, Abu Bakr al-Mirwadi. Abu Bakr, this guy is very well known in the Hanbali madhab. Abu Bakr al-Mirwadi. And he was very close to Imam Ahmad. One of the students of Abu Bakr al-Mirwadi is Abu Bakr al-Khallal. So Abu Bakr al-Mirwadi, the student of Imam Ahmad, has a student who's called Abu Bakr al-Khallal. That's very well known in fiqh. And he's the one who gathered the fiqh of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, taking it from his student al-Mirwadi, gathered it in a book, Al-Jami' al-Kabir, called Al-Jami' al-Kabir. Imam Ahmad sometimes has many opinions about one thing. So these are called al-riwayat, riwayat from Imam Ahmad. So you'll find sometimes about one issue, four riwayat from Imam Ahmad, four fatawa about it. These issues have been studied by a lot of the Hanbali scholars, and they tried to find like exactly what was the latest of Imam Ahmad's, okay, the latest of his fatawa. The Hanbali madhab, in terms of spreading, I said, well, it was mainly in Iraq where Imam Ahmad was. He was in Baghdad. Was also in Sham. Was in Sham. Okay, and this is why you have, for example, Ibn Taymiyyah was Hanbali. His student Ibn Qayyim was Hanbali as well. Ibn Kathir was Hanbali, yeah. Ibn Kathir was Hanbali, yes. Yeah, he was Hanbali. And also in Najd, in the middle of the Arabian Peninsula, Najd, where you have Unayza, Buraida, a little bit spread then afterwards into what's called Al-Yamama, which is Al-Riyadh, and in the east of what is known today Saudi Arabia. The fact that in the last, let's say, around 150, 200 years, that the Saudi government has adopted the Hanbali madhab, that helped its spread as well. So it took strong, it became the stronghold, Saudi became the stronghold of the Hanbali madhab, and that helped it spread and even develop. Specifically, when you're talking about Saudi, where Mecca and Medina are, so that gives it some, that helped spread the madhab in the last, let's say, 150 years. The fiqh of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal is mainly based, you'll find it heavily based on the hadith. Heavily based on the hadith. But the scholars of the Hanbali madhab later on developed a lot. They developed a lot and they got more into usul al-fiqh. They got more into usul al-fiqh, which is the principles, the dynamics behind the fiqh. And they built quite good heritage when it comes to usul al-fiqh. They're pretty much close to the Shafi'i as well. There are differences, but pretty much close as well to the Shafi'i, usul al-fiqh. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, Imam al-Shafi'i, when he was asked about Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, who did you leave, who did you know in Iraq is the most knowledgeable? He said, there's no one who knows more about the Quran, more about the Hadith, and no one who's more righteous that I left behind more than Imam Ahmad. Imam Ahmad was young still. So Imam al-Shafi'i praised a lot. He praised Imam Ahmad a lot. He praised him a lot. The scholars of Hadith as well, they all praised Imam Ahmad a lot. So basically, his madhab is heavily dependent on the Hadith. And he took advantage of his time that Hadith was documented. So he took advantage of all of this and he traveled and he learned the Hadith, he documented it. And having a base in Ar-Ra'i as well gave him a very good understanding. So he took advantage of all of this. But he decided deliberately not to lean so much into Ar-Ra'i and the use of reason, but he tried as much as possible to rely on the texts. But he used to use Qiyas. Like one of the funny stories, one of the fatawa that came to Imam Ahmad, because there are accusations. Like you have, for example, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. He says Imam Ahmad is a muhaddith, but he's not a faqih. He says he's muhaddith, but he's not faqih. He doesn't have a proper madhab. He is just a muhaddith. And there are others as well who held this opinion. But you have, for example, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, you know, saying this is nonsense. That doesn't make any sense. Look at Imam Ahmad's fiqh. It's a unique school of thought that has so much fiqh about it. And there are others as well who defended Imam Ahmad there. So he does actually. So this accusation was against Imam Ahmad, but because he depended heavily on the ahadith and he limited the scope for qiyas and for use of reason and for a bit more ijtihad, so this caused some people to hold this view about Imam Ahmad. One of the funny stories about Imam Ahmad that shows that he used to use reason. A question came to him that someone made an oath or a nadr. If something happens, that he would make tawaf around the Kaaba on four, ala arba'a, basically on his hands and knees. So he would basically crawl, make the tawaf crawling. So the question came to Imam Ahmad, what should this person do now? Does he have, like, what he asked for happened, so does he have to fulfill this oath now? So Imam Ahmad thought and he said, no. He said, this is an act of ibadah and it's not befitting for someone to do it like an animal, like how animals, you know, walk on four. Allah gave us the ability to stand on our feet. So he shouldn't be doing it. Then we respect the Kaaba, we don't do tawaf in that fashion around it. So he looked at it from a linguistic point of view. So he said, it's four. So he said, he makes tawaf seven times. Then he makes tawaf seven times. So some people actually at his time made fun of this fatwa, but later on the scholars, they said that shows very deep understanding. That for him, the way he looked at this, because he saw it as disrespect to the Kaaba and disrespect to the person. So he didn't want the person to do this. So he thought the best way to do it, to preserve the dignity of the Kaaba and the dignity of that Muslim. And since his oath was, لَأَطُوفَنَّ عَلَىٰ أَرْبَعَ, I shall make tawaf on four, basically meaning his hands and his knees. So he said, since it's four things, okay, once he walks it's on two, so in order to be able to make it up for the four, he makes two rounds of tawaf. First round seven, second round seven. And that's, by the way, that shows deep understanding, still shows deep understanding. Yeah, so that's generally speaking the story of, alhamdulillah, done with the four madahib. And as we said, these schools of thought were built by these scholars, but later on, they developed. The scholars who followed these schools of thought developed these madahib, and they added to them, and they modified them, and they clarified them, and they purified them, and so on and so forth. Unfortunately, later on, as we said, some people resorted to what we call ta'assub. Ta'assub, as we said, some sense of cynicism and bigotry against followers of other madahib. And they started to take the fiqh, and I'm talking about scholars and students of knowledge, take the fiqh without the texts. That's a bit problematic. That's problematic. But still, there were always within the madahib scholars who would also always take the fiqh, referring it back to the Qur'an and the Sunnah, see it in light of the principles of the founders of these madahib. So it was not a matter of, you know, challenging the Qur'an and the Sunnah by means of madahib. No, these were conduits, they were mainly means and pathways to help us understand and know how to implement the Qur'an and the Sunnah. So as I said, there appeared other madahib as well, like the madhab of Imam al-Awza'i. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari himself had a madhab. We saw a Zahiriyya, like Abu Dawood al-Zahiri, who was first a Shafi'i. Then he developed his own madhab, which is literalist, extreme literalist. And then it was taken by Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri in al-Andalus, in Spain. So there were pretty other madahib, but they started to fade away, except for mainly these four madahib. There were always people that they would be called Ahlul Hadith, who would emerge from within these madahib, who would still follow the hadith, So for example, you have among the Hanafis, let's say the Hanbalis, in the Hanbalis you have, for example, it's very like Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn al-Qayyim, the Hanbalis. But they would depart from the madhab. They're considered to be like among the Imams of Ahl al-Hadith, right? Among the Imams of the peoples who follow the Hadith. In a Shafi'i as well, you have a lot of scholars who would actually as well, like once they, Al-Muzani himself, the student of Imam al-Shafi'i, Al-Muzani himself, one of the biggest imams, that Shafi'iyya consider him mujtahidun mutlaq, like he reached the highest levels of ijtihad. He himself took opinions other than Imam Shafi'i's, although he's his most loyal student. So these are considered to be people of Ahl al-Hadith. Okay, anyway, so in all the madhab you will find, as I said, students or scholars who would still hold on to the madhab, but wherever they find there's a stronger point, finding it in the Qur'an, the Sunnah, there's more indication there, stronger indication, they would have no issues taking that, okay? And that shows, obviously, that's the way the madhab are supposed to, and that kept some growth in the madhab. But the ta'assub led to a decline in fiqh, led to decline in fiqh. Now, most of these books and the references that I've been looking into, they seem to be quite negative about what happened after the madhab, that there was a decline, closing the door for ijtihad. But in reality, I think that's a very like pessimistic view. It's not like this. Always been scholars coming up, mashallah, showing a lot of ijtihad, showing a lot of, they would renew the principles, and they would bring life back again into the fiqh, and so on and so forth. So there's always been showing up. So you have a lot of people in terms of their madhab that have really contributed greatly. So you would have uh,
specifically talking about in the Hanafi madhab, the al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya appeared. What's usually called in al-Hanafi fiqh, al-ashbah wal-nadha'ir, things that are similar. So the Hanafis really made great achievement when it comes to creating fiqhi maxims. And this was such a huge development. Until now, this science is developing. And it's such a powerful science. Al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. Al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. It started by al-Dabusi, by Imam al-Dabusi. And then later on, a lot of Ibn Nujaym al-Hanafi wrote al-Ashbah wal-Nadha'ir, the book al-Ashbah wal-Nadha'ir. So the Hanafi fiqh was rich with this. The Maliki fiqh developed the maqasid mainly, the science of maqasid, that really culminated with the writing of al-Muwafaqat by Imam al-Shatibi. This was such a profound advancement in fiqh. Although now it's considered to be out of fiqh, but it does inform and influence fiqh greatly, seeing the maqasid and the objectives of Sharia. Also, the Shafi'is are the ones who probably contributed the most to usul al-fiqh. They contributed the most to usul al-fiqh. So when you talk, for example, about Imam al-Qarafi, when he mentions just his book al-Furuq, the differences between things that seem to be similar, his contributions in usul al-fiqh, al-Razi, Imam al-Razi, in al-Mahsul, in usul al-fiqh, these are Shafi'is, okay? Al-Ghazali, his contribution to the fiqh al-Shafi'i. Imam al-Haramain al-Juwayni, his contribution is amazing to usul al-fiqh and to fiqh itself. You have in the Hanbali madhab, you have, it's enough, Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim. I mean, that's enough. That's it. Imam al-Nawawi for the Shafi'i as well is such a great contribution, the way he dealt with fiqh when he wrote his book al-Majmu' as well. The Hanbalis, you have Ibn Qudama wrote al-Mughni. It's more like an encyclopedia. Now we're talking about al-Hanbali, al-Mughni. And you have also Ibn Taymiyyah, as we said. Ibn Taymiyyah, his contribution to fiqh is so profound. It just is unbelievable. It's unbelievable, truly unbelievable. The way this man looked into fiqh, the way he used usul al-fiqh, the way he used the... Like, until today, there are thousands and thousands of dissertations in universities being produced based on the works of Ibn Taymiyyah. Thousands. People are getting, creating new fields of knowledge, new sciences, from the books of Ibn Taymiyyah. From the books of Ibn Taymiyyah. You can name it. Qira'at, which he's not known for, there's recently a PhD dissertation on this from Ibn Taymiyyah, his contributions in Qira'at. His fiqh, until now, scholars are still studying his fiqh. And there are so many books about the fiqh of Ibn Taymiyyah, exclusively taking his fiqh out of his books and classifying it as a book of fiqh. In terms of usul al-fiqh, Ibn Taymiyyah is just profound. In terms of aqidah, that's very well known. That's been probably the most focused aspect of Ibn Taymiyyah's books. It's been highlighted, the most highlighted. In terms of spirituality, Ibn Taymiyyah has not even been discovered yet. And he has profound statements. He has a profound system of spirituality within his books that has not been taken out, has not been exploited and used properly yet. It's profound. Ibn Taymiyyah was more spiritual than the biggest Sufis of all times. But he was not a Sufi. He had authentic spirituality. He was so profound in his spirituality. Like anything, you name it when it comes to Ibn Taymiyyah. Even the Maqasid, you will still find a lot of hints, powerful hints and points from Ibn Taymiyyah. His contributions to history, his contributions to philosophy, his responses in the field of logic and arguments. He responded to Aristotle, he responded to a lot of these Greek and Roman philosophers. He responds to them. Like one of his books is Ar-Radd ala al-Mantiqiyyin, a response to people of arguments and logic. This is probably such a profound book on philosophy.
His contributions to language, profound. Arabic language, morphology and grammar, unbelievable. To the semantics of the Arabic language, ilm al-ma'ani. These are, by the way, PhD dissertations that have been coming in, like each one, tens of them. Big numbers are coming out every year. Just getting, this man is amazing. So to say that the fiqh has gone down, it's probably maybe stalled a little bit, yes, but there are major trends that have really boosted the growth of fiqh. Now the problem is with our times. There are great efforts and endeavors here and there, but the problem is that there's no general trend that is picking up and gaining momentum. That's been the case in the last 300-400 years. That's the issue. That's the issue. And this is something probably we'll try to summarize and finalize and conclude inshallah next week. So next week most probably will be the last. If we might need another one for those who want to discuss their like research topics, that might be the case. But hopefully, I'm hoping inshallah, next meeting inshallah, we will conclude with the evolution of fiqh. If we don't, we'll just probably recap 2 weeks from now and then just finalize the research topics, and that would be it inshallah. For those who already chose their topics, I think we gave a deadline. What was the deadline? The end of the year, was it? January 1st. Jazakumullah khair. Barakallahu feekum wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam nabiyyina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.